Welcome to Corks, Chords, and Conversations. I'm your host, Marc Roland. I'm sitting here with guitarist Michael Harrison Gamble, drummer Alan Cook, and Andrew Jones on bass. And they just finished their performance at Roland Wines. I'm here to interview Mike Gamble. So sit back with us and let's learn more about Mike. He just played a gig here at Roland Wines, and I'm really excited to ask him a few questions about his life and what's going on. So the first question is for you, Mike, is you seem to be a very creative guy. Where did that come from?
I would say growing up at the time that I did, before the internet, I was listening to recordings by recommendations of various teachers that I had. And I took it to heart to go and try to find those recordings and also try to transcribe them all without anything else other than like a cassette player and a piece of paper, which is kind of nice. I feel like that's something that sparked a lot of creativity. Also, I grew up in the middle of Ohio, so I feel like that itself sort of lends itself to creativity in the sense that I just wanted to get out of Ohio and sort of was very curious of things happening since I was a child.
So where are your musical roots?
I started learning just kind of typical guitar, and I was playing left-handed, and my teacher originally just flipped it over and made me play right-handed. So I could have done that, but instead I just went with the approach of being a left-handed guitarist playing a right-handed guitar, which is okay. And then, yeah, like any other guitarist during, you know, the 80s or 90s, I got sort of obsessed with, you know, metal at the time and learning grunge rock and et cetera, et cetera. And it wasn't until I sort of learned about more adventurous music, I got into jazz and, like, you know, the classic, like, guitar virtuosos, like Joe Satriani, Jeff Beck, all those people. And by the time I got to high school, I just really kind of gave up on pop music because it was sort of after the grunge era, and the only thing I really liked was hip-hop. So I was like, okay, I'm just going to learn classical music, learn jazz music, and got influenced by all that. Went to school in Boston at New England Conservatory, and at that point, you know, I met a bunch of musicians like Andrew here that I just played with at a improv camp that I went to, and really just kind of my roots kind of developed in playing in everything from like a funk band to playing in like an experimental duo band to moving to New York with a trio that I still play with to this day called the In-Betweens, which is the son of Keith Jarrett, who plays bass. Noah Jarrett is his name, and a great drummer from Vermont called Connor Elms.
You mentioned the In-Betweens. How did that come to be, and what about the name?
We got started playing like a really funny sort of assortment of, I call them society gigs, as in like gigs where you're hired to play like at some benefit or maybe a wedding or this or that. We did that in Boston to make money. And we started the idea of that band because kind of all of us were not going to go with a traditional sort of graduating from college and trying to hire your teachers to do a record. We want to kind of start a band, more or less, rather than a guitar trio, more or less. So that was the impetus of that band, the In-Betweens. And it's kind of like, in a lot of ways, like the name says, like sort of surfing in between genres and surfing in between styles and whatnot.
What drove you out there on the edges of the cosmos?
I'd like to say a couple of things about some teachers that I studied with. I studied with Bob Moses, who now goes by Rock Alam. And he was at New England Conservatory, and he was always getting us to stretch as much as possible at all times within, you know, learning traditional music, traditional jazz it is, or just playing free music. And every Monday I would go to see this great saxophonist, George Garzon, who had this beautiful way of like teaching a chromatic approach to playing music. And then on top of that, I just have always been interested in anything from like studying experimental music from the 60s and before that to like new stuff that's coming out, like everything that happened in England during the sort of like electronic phase of Warp Records to like anything that's happening today with people freaking out with mini pedals and you know, audio reactive like visual software, et cetera, et cetera. Yeah, it sort of just keeps going.
We are talking to Michael Harrison Gamble and his friends, Andrew Jones and Alan Cook, after their gig here at Roland Wines. Mike, you've lived in a lot of cities. What's the Portland music scene like?
I actually moved to Portland because I was looking for sort of like a change of pace. Like in New York City, I was living in Brooklyn for 10 years. And my partner and I were going to be moving upstate, and this sort of like idea of a job like popped up sort of last minute. There's a health concern with somebody, and he was like, yeah, do you want to apply for a college teaching job? And, you know, I'm just making a call, like it's a last minute thing. And I was like, well, I can't fly to Oregon right now. Instead, I just did a phone interview, and, you know, he was like, yeah, send me your resume and your CV. And eventually moved to Corvallis, where I taught at Oregon State, and then kind of just immediately wanted to move to Portland and check out the scene there. And one of the first things I did was go to a show that the Creative Music Guild was putting on. And I was going to see this cello player who I played with on tour with this band called Earth, this like doom metal band. Her name's Lori Goldston. She's a great cello player that played in Nirvana, played with a bunch of great Northwest artists, David Byrne. She had her own band that did like played along to films called the Black Cat Orchestra. And we connected in Portland of all places at a Creative Music Guild show. And I just immediately was like, wow, there's an insanely sort of like experimental scene here that also, you know, people like myself and Andrew like play in bands that are experimental, but also play in like singer-songwriter projects or like more rock bands and do some tracks with like hip-hop artists, all that stuff. It's that whole scene is kind of festering in Portland.
I'm a big fan of Wilco, and I noticed that you played with Nels Klein and some other pretty famous artists. Can you tell me what that was like?
Nels Klein. I met Nels Klein at a gig with this bass player, Todd Sickafoos, who I met and I was playing a bunch with in New York City. We had one gig, thank you, in Los Angeles where we played a set at this place called the Temple Bar. This band Kneebody was playing before us, and then Nels did this set with this guy. Oh, geez, now I'm spacing on his name. He's a visual artist, and he basically was like splashing paint everywhere. And he, do you know what that guy is? It's on the tip of my tongue too. But anyways, he did a duo set, and then in the middle of the set with Todd Sickafoos' band, Todd was like, okay, there's going to be a moment where we're going to play this tune, and in the middle of the tune, everybody's going to go off stage, and you're going to play 14 minutes of like duo with Nels Klein. And I was like, okay, great, awesome. I've never met him, but yeah, we basically met on stage because he couldn't even make it to soundcheck, and we like basically met just by playing improvised duo loopy kind of stuff for 14 minutes. And then ever since then, we've been friends and we've done a couple shows together. And yeah, just been in touch. He was responsible for helping me to like pick out the right jazz master because he's sort of like the jazz master. And he also like hilariously, like, you know, responded to a huge long text that I sent to him about like sort of like diving into like what does it mean to even be a jazz master sort of negates itself. And he's like, are you okay? Are you doing all right? You just need a freaking new guitar. So just call me. So he's a super nice guy.
Tell me about the audio video series. What is an audio reactive projection setup?
Well, it depends. You can do it in so many ways where you can work with this other guitar that I have. It has a octophonic MIDI pickup on it. So it kind of like it tracks every string itself. And then you can send those to different channels and different like frequency bands, filters or whatnot, and then set those to like various audio things. Various visual elements. Like if you want to like have a kaleidoscope and set the amounts of rotations to happen to like, you know, the velocity of your frequency, you can do something like that. You can hit a foot switch and it can cue the next scene of like whatever short film that you're doing or like a narrative film or whatnot. It depends. You can do things with not only like sequences of different clips of different pieces of stuff that you do, but you can also tie in like a live video that that's being projected behind you and also is reacted to the counterparts of what you're playing like live. Like there's pretty much the cat's out of the bag, and is that a term? Cat's out of the bag. At this point, you know, and there's so many ways you can sort of approach it, depending if you're doing more experimentive versus like narrative film versus like playing along with a track or like something like exactly how it goes and just deviating slightly, like depending on what you're playing, the notes, the velocity of it, et cetera, et cetera.
Tell me about Portland's Creative Music Guild.
Well, since I was saying, like, I went to the first show in Portland that the CMG was putting on a couple of years afterwards, I got asked to be the artistic director, and I've been doing that since 2016. And essentially, the nonprofit's been around since, like, 1991. This gentleman, Rich Holly, sort of started it and then passed it on to so many other people, blah, blah, blah. And, yeah, I've been doing it. Putting on shows like this year, we've done, a 13-day festival, which we had everybody from like Montana Roberts to, Craig Taborn to like some insanely beautiful local artists, to like, you know, just the other week we had, Miles Okazaki, a great guitarist, and Dan Weiss do like a workshop. And, that was great. Alan came down to check it out. And yeah, we essentially do like a couple different counterparts of the sort of programming, which is one is the local scene called the Outset Series, and then one is called the Confluence Scene, where we bring artists from outside of town. We just had this great saxophone player, Trevor Watts, who's from England, part of like the whole English sort of improv scene. He's 81 and he played like a 90-minute set at one of our venues we had a series called the Extradition Series, which was sort of like new music meets improvisation. And then we had another series called the Discordance Series, which was like all the punk rock sort of like noise musicians in town. And we're just continuing kind of finding more grants money and finding more support to keep it going. It's not easy by any means. It's a volunteer organization, so we're all just in it to get more money to the artists, essentially, that we're bringing to town and artists that are in town as well.
Hey, Mike, how can people get a hold of you?
But Instagrams is one way to see me online, and my website is mikegamble.me, and then you can always like shoot me an email through that or through actually the Creative Music Guild itself. So it's creativemusicguild.org. And at the bottom of the first page, there's a little hyperlink that says donate, and you can donate monthly, or you can just give us like a one-time sort of tax deductible donation.
How did you come to meet Alan Cook?
I met Alan Cook, I believe, at a CMG show, and we ended up playing our first gig together. where we were sharing a bill in Corvallis, actually, at this place. And he was playing with a singer-songwriter. I was doing, I think, a solo set. And, yeah, that was the first time we, like, kind of shared the stage and wanting to play, and played some shows in Portland, and then been doing this a couple couple times. I had the great chance to play this with John Gross and Xiaowei Wu and Alan this summer, which is the first time I went here. Very, very gorgeous sort of like midsummer day. And it's nice to play inside as well. This is really, really special place.
That concludes our conversation with Mike Gamble, guitarist extraordinaire from Portland, Oregon. Thanks for joining us. If you'd like to hear more of this type of conversation, go to Corks, Chords, and Conversations on Spotify and other podcasting platforms. So long.